Good morning, Harvest. How's everybody doing? Good. Look over to the person next to you and say, I'm so glad you're here today. It's so good to be in the house of the Lord. Amen. To worship the Lord, to dive into God's word, to worship together. It's going to be a great morning. If you don't know me, I'm Stephanie Geisler. I'm the Central Women's Director here at Harvest. I serve on multiple campuses and get to help with women's ministry and teaching classes, and it's super fun. It's just a joy to be together this morning. This is your first time here. Special welcome to you. Glad you decided to join us today, to join us for church. We're a really welcoming community, so feel free to ask anyone any questions. I'll be in the lobby after service. I'd love to meet you, answer any questions you have. I'll be at the table that says welcome in the middle of the lobby, so I'd love to meet you and help you get plugged in here at Harvest. For everyone here, we want to make sure you're getting plugged into the life of the church. Church isn't just something you attend. It's something you're a part of. It's something you become. It's something you belong to. And so one of the ways we make sure you're plugged in is through the Connect card on the Harvest Bible Chapel app. So pull out your phones right now. This is the time to use your phone in church. So pull out your phone and click the Connect card on the Harvest Bible Chapel app, which is on Church Center, and let us know that you're here today. Also, let us know any prayer requests. Every week, we take time as a staff to pray over those prayer requests, and I love getting to text people and hear those answered prayers and getting to pray with people and partner with people throughout the week. So make sure you take some time to fill that out. This summer has been so awesome. There's been so many cool things that God has been doing in the life of our church. Right now, we have junior high students coming back from Camp Harvest. We're really excited to see what God has done through Camp Harvest. But also, a couple weeks ago, we had High Five. And if you don't know what High Five is, it's basically just a giant vacation Bible school. High energy, super fun, diving into God's word. And so we had a lot of kids across our campuses getting to spend time in God's word, having a lot of fun. And we had leaders and staff all pouring into it. So we want to show you a video so you can see what all was going on.
All of us every day have choices to make. There's God's way and the wrong way. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego chose God's way. And you know what, gang? If they can do it, all of us can do it.
For there is salvation in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given among men by which we must be saved. Acts 4:12.
It's all about Jesus.
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 High Five is all about Jesus!
That is awesome. It's so cool to see what God did at High Five, and God's not done. So we're going to continue to pray for the kids that went to High Five, for the kids that came to know the Lord during High Five week, and also just for our Harvest Kids ministry. Our Harvest Kids are incredible. Our leaders, our staff, they love the Lord, and they are passionate about discipling kids. And so we're going to take some time during our service today to pray for the fruit of Harvest Kids and for that ministry there. We're also going to be praying for a local church. We always pray for another church in our area that's doing the mission of the Lord. And we're going to be praying for the Bridge Church in Des Plaines and Pastor Junior Ziegler. Their church is doing incredible things, and we're so excited to see how God continues to use the Bridge. But also, we want to pray for our service today. We're going to be diving into Jeremiah 1. We're starting a new sermon series today that's about the prophets. And so if you've ever studied the prophets, it's very rich, and it's going to be really cool to see what God does during this sermon series. And so Pastor Tommy will be preaching today. So let's pray together as we dive in to God's word and as we worship. Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you for who you are. God, you are holy, you are righteous, you are set apart, and Lord, we come humbly before you. Lord, we thank you that we can gather together as a church family and worship you and declare who you are. You are worthy of all of our praise and all of our adoration. God, we thank you for what you did at High Five. We thank you for how you're working in the lives of the next generation. Lord, we pray for a generation that is passionate about you, God. We pray for a generation that is on mission for you. So Lord, we pray for Harvest Kids. We pray for our leaders. We pray for the staff that, God, you help empower them even now as they are pouring into the kids right now during service. Lord, we pray that we have new volunteers be raised up to serve and disciple children in our church. Lord, we pray that through High Five, through the camps, that kids don't just get excited about camp or excited about High Five, but they get excited about the Lord. So Lord, we pray that you just do a mighty work in the next generation here at our church. Lord, we pray for the bridge. Lord, I thank you for Pastor Junior Ziegler. Lord, I thank you for the work they're doing there. Lord, I pray that you just have a mighty work, a mighty hand at that church, Lord. You continue to revive, bring in new people, and Lord, that they're just a light in their community. And Lord, I pray for our service today. Lord, may we worship in spirit and in truth. Lord, I pray that you help us to rid ourselves of anything that could hinder our worship, our attitude towards you, Lord. Lord, we want to know you. We want to be able to experience you more today than yesterday. So we thank you that we can come before you humbly. So Lord, I pray that you be with Pastor Tommy as he preaches this morning. Lord, that you would go before him, that Lord, you would just anoint him afresh for the preaching of your word. And Lord, that you be glorified in every part of our service today. Lord, it is a joy to worship you today. You are holy, you are righteous, and Lord, we are so expectant for what you're gonna do today. We love you, in Jesus' name, amen. Let's stand and worship together.
Amen. In Psalm 100, it says, enter his gates with thanksgiving in our hearts, enter his courts with praise. Let's sing this out together.
It's a doorway into heaven. It's the password to his presence. Oh, we give thanks. It defeats all disappointments, fills a house with holy moments. Oh, we give thanks. Oh, we give thanks. We enter his gates with hearts full of praise. We sing of his goodness, we sing of his grace. His love is forever, so now and forever. With joy that can't be broken, oh, we give thanks. Our worship rises up for the wonders of his love. Oh, we give thanks. Oh, we give thanks. We enter his gates with hearts full of praise.
Oh,
your hands, lift your voice. We worship you, Jesus. We honor you, Lord.
Yeah. I have been saved by the grace of God, amen. I have been to a future without end. I set my eyes,
yes we do,
on a true and loyal friend, the one whose life I'm hidden.
Oh, come on church, we're here to declare his name together.
Oh Jesus, and all my hope in
Jesus,
alone.
The
family of my God, I will be named. When the saints go marching on, he is the prize. Oh, my salvation and my song, the only one I'm counting on. Oh, Jesus, all my hope is
to him be the glory. Oh, let his people shout through all generations. And amen, amen.
Now to him be the glory. And who is able to do
shout his victory through all
generations. And amen, amen.
give me vision to see things like you do. God, I look to you, 'cause you're where my health comes from. Give me wisdom, 'cause you know just what to do. Yes, you know what to do. You know just what to do, and I will love you, Lord, my strength you are. And I will love you, Lord, my shield. And I will love you, Lord, my rock. Forever, all my days, I will love you, God.
Thank you.
us to trust you, Lord. God, I look to you. You're where my help comes from. Give me wisdom, 'cause you know just what to do. Oh, you always know, God. So help us to trust you, Lord. Help us to trust you. So hallelujah, our God reigns. And hallelujah, our God reigns. And hallelujah, our God, you reign forever all my day. Hallelujah.
I love that song where it says, God reigns above it all. His ways are perfect. His timing is perfect. He's a heavenly Father that provides every single thing for us. I don't know about you, but sometimes my mind is ruled with worry. Worry about the future, worry about finances, or worry about life in general. I worry about things that I ultimately can't control, but I love Jesus in Matthew 6 where he says, look at the birds of the air. They do not sow or reap or store away in barns, and yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not much more valuable than they? Therefore, do not worry, saying, what shall we eat, or what shall we drink, or what shall we wear? For the pagans run after all of these things, and your heavenly Father knows that you need them. But seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well. Each week we set time in our service to give to him, the one who has given everything to us. We give, set free from the thought that finances are our security. We give as people set free from worry, because we know that our God is our ultimate provider. The ways to give will be on your screen. You can give in so many different ways. But our prayer is that as you give, that you can see our God as a faithful Father. And I'm going to pray for our offering, and we're going to sing a new song, actually, that speaks into this, that our God is a God who will provide. So let's pray. Thank you, Father, that you are our provider, that every single need has been met because of you. And you have everything that we need. And Lord, we trust you in this moment, whether if we have little or whether we have much, Lord, we trust you as we give. We know that you're gonna use it, you're gonna multiply it for your glory, for your honor, to advance the kingdom, for the gospel to go forth from this place to the ends of the earth, that all may know, that all will hear that you are Lord. And so Lord, we trust you in this time. Thank you that you have provided every single need for us. And we give you all the glory. We give you all the honor. In Jesus' name, amen.
Look at the flowers and all of the beauty. I don't have to wonder, you know what you do.
That's right.
So why would I worry at all? 'Cause you're faithful to supply. We sing everything. Oh, everything I need, everything I need, my Father has it. Oh,
Christ he does. Every single thing we need, he has.
Oh, look at the sparrow, lacking for nothing. No fear of tomorrow and what it will bring. You're more than enough. If I have you, I have enough. 'Cause your love will satisfy everything we need. Everything I need. Everything I need. I know my Father has. Oh, my Father has. But every single time, the Lord will provide. My Father has. Oh, my Father has. Yes, he does. Yes, he does. Come on, this is our response to him today. So seek first the kingdom and its treasures, and everything else it will be added, and all that I'm needing. That's right. And I know the Lord will provide. Come on, how many believe that today? Oh, I know my God's not empty-handed, 'cause he gives us blessings upon blessings. Oh, I'm still believing.
Worship a God that provides every single thing. He's faithful and he's worthy of our praise. Hey, before we jump into the message, why don't you say hi to someone around you?
Well, good morning, church. Good morning. Good to see you. Good to see you. Oh, what a pleasure it is to see you. If you're new here, my name's Tommy Creutz. I serve as the campus pastor of our Crystal Lake campus and also on our teaching team, and it is a privilege to bring God's word to us today. And wouldn't you know, you're going to need your Bible, and we are going to be in Jeremiah chapter 1. And so turn on over to there. We're going to go through the whole chapter. And as you're turning there, I want to ask you a question. Have you ever been reluctant to do something? Anyone? Anyone ever been reluctant to do anything? Every hand should be up right now. Yes, I have been reluctant. Maybe you have been reluctant to do something like public speaking, standing in front of people and talking. And maybe you've been asked to share a speech at a wedding or speak at a party or speak at a work event in front of people, and you've been a little reluctant to do that. I don't know if I'm the best person for the job. I don't speak so well. I'm just a little. I don't think I'm the right choice for that. Maybe you've been reluctant in purchasing something that's a little bit of money. Like, oh, I don't know, that's a lot of money. Are we sure that we need that? Are we sure? Just a little. There's a little bit of reluctance. Maybe guys, for you, have you ever been reluctant in asking for help at Home Depot? But I have. You know what? I'm going to spend the next 3 hours looking for this obscure part that I'm not even sure is at Home Depot, and I'm not asking anyone for help. All right? No directions. No help. You know, one of the things that I'm most reluctant to do is any type of handiwork. I am not gifted in working with my hands at all. And you might be thinking in your mind, well, you can't be that bad. Yes, I am. If you were to grade me on a scale of 0 to 100, I would be negative 50. And my wife, she asks me to do projects around the house. And I am very reluctant to do any of those projects. But I am happy to announce to you that over the Sabbath, for our staff, I put in a brand new mailbox, which, thank you. It might not be a big deal to you, but that's a big thing for me. And so we, our brother-in-law bought a mailbox, and apparently that mailbox didn't match his house, which I didn't even know that people did that with their mailboxes, but they do. And so it didn't match. And so he gave it to us, and I finally put it in 2 weeks ago after it has been sitting in my garage for a year and a half. So pretty reluctant to do it, and if you thought that was bad, I watched a bunch of YouTube videos on it, and I found this video. It was a step-by-step, no cuts, just straight through. This is exactly how you put in a mailbox, how you take one out, how you put one in. It took the guy 30 minutes to do it. You know how long it took me? 6 hours. That's how bad I am. And so needless to say, I'm a little reluctant to do any sort of projects or handiwork because one, I'm inadequate, I stink at it. And two, it takes me so long to do anything that a normal person can do. It takes me 3, 4, 5, 6 times as long to do it. And so I am so reluctant to do that. And we're all like this, right? We all have things in our life where we don't feel adequate or we don't feel prepared. And so we're reluctant to step into something. And we're going to see that in our text today. We're going to see someone who's reluctant to step into something. We're starting a new series today called Thus Saith the Lord. And in this series, we're going to be walking through a series in the prophets. And over the next about 6 weeks, we're going to be looking at some major prophets, some minor prophets, all different prophets, and seeing what we can grab out of them. And so today, we're going to be starting with Jeremiah. And the title of our time is This Guy Was a Bullfrog. I'm just kidding. That's not... It's not the title. For those of you who get it, yeah. The title is Reluctant Prophet, Jeremiah 1, 4 through 19. And the reason that we chose this in particular to kind of start us off is because there's really great principles for us in the text. But also, I'm hoping that this is going to be, it's going to help as an introduction into our series on the prophets. Really understanding what a prophet is and what do prophets do. And hopefully that's not just going to be helpful for us today, but it's going to be helpful for us in the weeks to come. And so we're going to break down Jeremiah 1 into a couple of sections. First, God's plan, then God's provision, then God's purpose, and lastly, God's promise. So pretty simple outline for us. We're going to start in verse 4, starting with the first thing, God's plan. Let's look at Jeremiah chapter 1, verse 4. God's plan says this. Now the word of the Lord came to me saying, before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. And before you were born, I consecrated you. I appointed you a prophet to the nations. And so what we see right off the bat in the plain text is that God has a plan for Jeremiah. Now the word of the Lord came to me, Jeremiah. And then God shares his plan with him. He's revealing to Jeremiah his plan for his life. And he does this through different I statements. Did you see? There's four of them in the text. Before I formed you. In the womb, I knew you. There's two others. We'll get to them in a moment. Before I formed you. Let's go through each of these. I formed you. And this is such an incredible thing, isn't it? That God intentionally formed Jeremiah into the person that he was to become. He formed him intentionally, meticulously created him. A little aside from the sermon, maybe you're new to Christianity or you're exploring Christianity and you have been wondering, why are Christians so adamant about the sanctity of human life? Why are Christians so passionate about this issue of abortion? Why? It's because of verses like this, where God says that I form you. He creates intentionally in the womb, knits us together, other passages say, that we are a work of God. The Bible teaches us not that we are, the Bible doesn't teach us that we are a clump of cells that have no value or meaning, but that we are formed by the living God. And therefore, we are created in his image, and therefore we have massive inherent value given to us by God. That is why Christians are so passionate about that issue. And so God formed Jeremiah. He formed him. And before he did that, before he formed Jeremiah in the womb, it says that I knew you. I knew you. God chose Jeremiah for relationship. He chose him for relationship before he was even born. Before he was even in the womb, God chose Jeremiah for relationship. The Lord was thinking about Jeremiah before he was even in the womb. Before he was even formed, God was thinking about Jeremiah. He goes on to say, and before you were born, I consecrated you. Which means that God, before Jeremiah was born, God set Jeremiah apart for his plans and his purposes. And he appointed, says, I appointed you a prophet to the nations. Before Jeremiah was even born, God planned for him to be a prophet. Before he was born, God had a job already picked out for Jeremiah. He was going to be a prophet. It is clear that God has planned Jeremiah's life. Amen? He has planned it. And the reality is that every life is planned by God. And God had a specific, unique calling for his prophets, and in this text, Jeremiah, to be a prophet to the nations. But God has a plan for all of our lives. God has a plan for my life. God has a plan for your life. God has planned, before we were even formed, God knew us and had a plan for our lives. The way that we say this around here is that we have been uniquely planted, that God has formed us. We have a unique story. We have unique passions and abilities and all of those working together. We have a unique plant. We have been uniquely planted into the places that we have been. It is not a mistake that you live in the neighborhood that you live, in the house that you live. It is not a mistake that you work at the job that you work at. It is not a mistake that you are in the family that you are in. It is not a mistake. It is God's unique planting for your life. It's a uniquely planted life where we work, where we live, where we play to be on mission for Jesus Christ. He has a plan for our life. And maybe you're thinking, well, that's just, we just see this in Jeremiah. No, we also see this in Psalm 139. It says, for you formed my inward parts. You knitted me together in my mother's womb. I praise you, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Wonderful are your works. My soul knows it very well. My frame was not hidden from you when I was being made in secret, intricately woven in the depths of the earth. Your eyes saw my unformed substance. In your book were written, every one of them, the days that were formed for me, when as yet there was none of them. Do you see this? God has a plan for every life. We were formed in our mother's womb. He knew us, even our unformed substance. He knows every day of our life, how many, how long they will be. We are fearfully and wonderfully made. We are each unique. In our fingerprints, in our DNA, in our story, in our abilities, in our passions. God has a plan for each and every one of us, a purpose for each and every one of us. Have you ever thought about that for your own life? What is it that God has for you? What is it that God has for you? We see very clearly here that God's plan for Jeremiah is for him to be a prophet to the nations. What is that for you? What does God have for your life? What is your unique planting? Where have you been uniquely planting in serving him? You know, I can't talk about that and not talk about a resource that we have in our church. Coming up in the fall, we have a class called My Design that's going to be happening, I believe, on pretty much every one of our campuses. And I would just encourage you, this is a class to discover this exact thing. How our passions and abilities and story come together to find where we have been uniquely planted by God to do the mission of God. And so you don't have to wait until the fall to start figuring this out. You can do that now, but I just want to give you a resource for the fall. I would encourage every person in our church to come to this, especially if you don't know, to come to this and figure out how God has uniquely planted you and where he has uniquely planted you to live and work and play and be on mission for Jesus Christ. So God has a plan. It's the first thing that we see. The next thing that we're gonna see is God's provision. God's provision. In verse 6, chapter 1, Jeremiah. Jeremiah then I said, appropriate response to the Lord talking to you. Lord God, behold, I do not know how to speak, for I am only a youth. But the Lord said to me, do not say I am only a youth. For to all to whom I send you, you shall go. And whatever I command you, you shall speak. Do not be afraid of them, for I am with you to deliver you, declares the Lord. So Jeremiah just heard the plan that God has for him. He just hears this plan that God has for him, and needless to say, he's a little reluctant. He's a little reluctant. And he's got some excuses. God, I heard you, but I just don't know if you know. I don't speak very well. I don't know how to speak. I'm young. I'm only a youth. Surely you don't mean me to be a prophet to the nations. Are you sure about that? He's got some excuses. He has some excuses, and I love it. The Lord says he hears the excuse, and he's like, no excuses, Jeremiah. Do not say I am only a youth. I know that you feel like that's an excuse, but don't say that. That's not an excuse. It's not an excuse. And I hope that verses like this are an encouragement to all of those who are young in our church. Jeremiah was probably mostly in his late teens, most likely in his late teens, for sure under probably 20. So he pretty young, right? And God says to Jeremiah, your youth isn't an excuse not to step into the calling that I have for you. Don't say, because I am only a youth, that I can't do this. It's not an excuse to step into the calling that I have placed on your life. You are not too young to step into the calling that God has for you. And that's true of Jeremiah, and that is true of every young person in our church. You are not too young to step into the calling that God has placed on your life. You don't have to wait until a certain age, when you're out of your parents' house, to step into the calling that God has placed on your life. You do not have to do that. It is not an excuse. Youth is not an excuse. And in fact, God doesn't just say that here. There's a very famous verse, 1 Timothy 4:11, that says, let no one despise you for your youth. But set the believers an example in speech, in conduct, in love, in faith, in purity. Youth is not an excuse to not step into the call that God has placed on your life. So step in. Step in. It doesn't matter if you don't know how to speak or if you are only a youth. Those are Jeremiah's excuses. And really, when you think about it, those are his spoken excuses to God. There's also an unspoken excuse that Jeremiah has. And the unspoken excuse that Jeremiah has is that I'm afraid. He says, I don't know how to speak and I am only a youth. But there's an unspoken excuse of I'm afraid. And God actually addresses that in verse 8. He says, do not be afraid. Do not be afraid. Jeremiah is afraid of what God is calling him into because he is young, because he doesn't know how to speak well. And I think that we can all really relate to Jeremiah here, right? We've all been afraid. God, you want me to go and speak to people about you? In this culture? I know your word, and I'm probably gonna be saying some things to them that they're not gonna wanna hear. I'm not sure that I'm gonna have the right words to say, or I'm gonna even say things correctly. I don't even know if I have enough knowledge about your word to really do this. What if they reject me? What if they think about me differently? How could I possibly be leading other people in discipleship? How could I be a student small group leader? How could I be discipling children in children's ministry? How could I be leading a community group or a discipleship group or leading in a ministry? I don't know how to do any of those things. I'm afraid. I'm afraid of what people might think about me. I'm afraid of how they're gonna react to me. I'm afraid of my own inadequacy. We can all relate to Jeremiah here, being afraid. So what does God do with Jeremiah's excuses? Well, first he says, no excuses. But then he lets him know how he's gonna provide what he needs. He knows Jeremiah is afraid, and so he reassures him. He knows Jeremiah feels inadequate, so he reassures him. He said, I will be with you to deliver you, declares the Lord. He reassures him. And he does the same for us so that we can look to God and not allow our excuses to keep us from serving him. In fact, we can jump in to serve and watch how God gives us exactly what we need. God provides everything that we need through his presence with us. His provision in this, to Jeremiah, to us, his provision is his presence. He is with us. You see it? I am with you to deliver you, declares the Lord. His provision is his presence, and in his presence is his power, is his protection, supplying every need that we have. He is with us. And what if we thought like that? When we bring our excuses to God, God, I'm inadequate. I'm inadequate to the thing that you have called me to do. But I know that you are with me. I said that right before I came up here. I said, Lord, I'm inadequate. I don't speak too good. But I know that you are with me. And because you are with me, I don't have to be afraid. I can step into the calling that you have placed in my life. So what if we did that with every excuse that we have to stay away from what God has called us to? Like, Lord, that's gonna hurt. That's gonna be tough, but I know that you're with me. Lord, I'm not good at that, but I know that you are with me. God, I don't have enough knowledge of your word, but I know that you are with me. And I know because you are with me, you will supply every need that I have. What would that do to our dependence on God? What would that do to grow our faith? To say yes to the Lord, because we know that he is with us. And this is comforting Jeremiah to walk into some pretty difficult ministry that is ahead because God is with him. So God's plan, God's provision. Here's a third thing, God's purpose. God's purpose. Let's look at verse 9, chapter 1, verse 9. Then the Lord put out his hand and touched my mouth, Lord's provision. And the Lord said to me, behold, I have put my words in your mouth. See, I have set you this day over nations and over kingdoms to pluck up and to break down, to destroy and to overthrow, to build and to plant. This is God's purpose for his prophet. And so when we look at this, we kind of get an idea of what the role of God's prophet is through this text. The Lord put his hand out and touched Jeremiah's mouth and said to him, behold, I have put my words in your mouth. So what is a prophet? A prophet is the spokesperson for God. He is a person. They are a person who God puts his words in their mouth. They are spokespeople for God. They proclaim God's word, his very word that has been placed in their mouth. They proclaim God's word. That is what a prophet is. They are also called to pluck up, to break down, to destroy, to overthrow, to build, and to plant. This is the purpose of a prophet as well. To pluck up, break down, destroy, overthrow, build, and plant. This is imagery that shows us that the function, the role of the prophet is to warn of the coming judgment of God. The plucking up, the breaking down, the destruction, the overthrowing, the judgment of God. It is also the role of a prophet to build and to plant, to bring encouragement and hope of the promises of restoration when they repent and turn back to the Lord. And I think that the order here is really important, that there is first a plucking up, a breaking down, a destruction, a judgment, a warning of judgment that is coming, and then an encouragement and hope. If you think about it a little bit about like a house, maybe a condemned house or a condemned building, and it is about to fall over, the foundation is rough, the walls are rough, and at any moment it could just collapse. The thing that you don't do is just build on top of that. Because what's gonna happen? It's gonna fall down again, right? What we do is when we see a condemned building that is destroyed, we destroy it, we demolish it and build over top it, right? We build in the new place. When you're planting, maybe crop for the field, what do you just have all of the crop and then just go and plant some more? No, you have to reap the crop and then go and plant. And so I think the order here is important, that judgment is coming. There is a plucking up, a breaking down, a destroying and overthrowing, and then a building and a planting. So prophets, they warn of the judgment that is coming, and they also encourage the hope and promises of restoration. And I think sometimes when we think about prophets, we think about them exclusively in terms of like predicting the future. And we hear prophet and we think of prophecy and we think of future telling, and that's how we kind of view the prophets, is that their role really is to predict the future. And while that's true, prophets definitely do predict things that come in the future, really that's kind of a secondary aspect to the prophet. I would say that the primary aspect of a prophet is that they declare what God has already spoken. They declare what God has already spoken. They remind Israel of what God's word is, what he has already said. For example, his covenant. If Israel violates the terms of the covenant, if they walk away from the terms of the covenant, then the curses of the covenant will come on Israel. If they follow the covenant, they will receive blessing, the blessing of the covenant. Israel's prophets often reminded Israel of these curses of the covenant and called them to repentance over and over and over and over and over again. And then they also predict. But mostly what they predict are things that are going to happen in the near future. Not necessarily our future, although there is some prophecy that predicts things in our future. But mostly the things that they predict are in their near future. Warning of the coming judgment of God. In fact, that's what we're gonna see in Jeremiah chapter 1 here. Verse 11, and the word of the Lord came to me saying, Jeremiah, do you see what do you see? And I said, I see an almond branch. Then the Lord said to me, you have seen well, for I am watching over my word to perform it. This first thing that God has given Jeremiah to see, the almond branch, he says, yes, I see it. The Lord says, you have seen well, for I'm watching over my word to perform it. And this is both, I think for us, a warning and an encouragement. For Jeremiah, for sure, a warning. This is a warning for Israel who has forsaken God. They have gone astray and they have worshiped other gods and worshiped the works of their own hands. They have forsaken God and God is watching over his word to perform it. So when God has said that if you walk away, if you go after other gods, you will receive curses, God is watching over his word to perform it. He will do what he said he will do. And when he said, if you worship other gods, you will be cursed, he is watching over his word to perform it. This is a warning. It's a warning for us too, but it's also an encouragement, especially for us, because we have God's very words. And he is watching over all of it to perform it. He will do what he said he will do. Every promise that he has given us, he will do what he said he will do. He is watching over his word to perform it. And so we can be totally, completely confident in the word of God and bringing the word of God to others. Why? Because God is watching over his word to perform it. He will do what he said he will do. Goes on, says, the word of the Lord came to me a second time saying, what do you see? And I said, I see a boiling pot facing away from the north. Then the Lord said to me, out of the north, disaster shall be let loose upon all the inhabitants of the land. For behold, I am calling all the tribes of the kingdoms of the north, declares the Lord. And they shall come, and every one shall set his throne at the entrance of the gates of Jerusalem, against all its walls and around and all around and against all the cities of Judah. And I will declare my judgments against them for all their evil in forsaking me. They have made offerings to other gods and worshiped the works of their own hands. Do you see it? Israel is astray. They are worshiping other gods. They are worshiping the works of their own hands. They have forsaken God and his covenant. And God is saying judgment is coming like a boiling pot about to be dropped on them and scolding them. That he is going to use the inhabitants of the north, the tribes of the kingdoms of the north, to come and destroy. In fact, we know that it's the Babylonians. We know that the Babylonians are going to come and destroy Jerusalem. And in fact, a significant amount of Jeremiah is about that day coming, when that will take place. God's judgment is on his people for their disobedience to his covenant. And they are about to experience the destruction of that. We see in Deuteronomy 30, you're gonna see some similar language here. This is what God says. God's word says in Deuteronomy 30, see, I have set before you today life and good, death and evil. If you obey the commandments of the Lord your God that I command you today, by loving the Lord your God, by walking in his ways and by keeping his commandments and his statutes and his rules, then you shall live and multiply. And the Lord your God will bless you in the land that you are entering to take possession of it. But if your heart turns away and you will not hear, but you are drawn away to worship other gods and serve them, I declare today to you today that you shall surely perish. You shall not live long in the land that you are going over the Jordan to enter and possess. I call heaven and earth to witness against you today that I have set before you life and death, blessing and curse. Do you see the similarities there? Do you see it? Do you see the call back now from Jeremiah to what God has already said? God said, if you do this, death is coming, curse is coming. If you go astray and worship other gods, this is what is coming. This is a call back to the text of what God has already said. and what he has already said that he will do. And Israel has turned from the Lord and they have worshiped other gods. And Jeremiah is to remind them of what God has said. That judgment is coming and they need to repent and to turn back to the Lord. This is the main purpose of the prophets. So what does that mean for us? What does this all mean for us? This is the purpose of prophets. I think for you and for me, one thing that we can do when we read things like this is we can heed the call of the prophets to repent and to turn to the Lord. To repent. Maybe you are here and you have gone astray. You have forsaken the Lord. You have sinned against him. You have gone after other gods, worshiped other idols, worshiped the works of your own hand. The call is to repent. Choosing sin is choosing destruction. In your life, the effects of sin are devastating. They are death. They are destruction in our lives. As we have sinned, we have experienced this, haven't we? We've experienced the destruction that it causes, and it is devastating. And the call is to repent, to turn to the Lord for the forgiveness of our sin. 1 John 1:9, if you confess your sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And you can turn in repentance today and receive the forgiveness and cleansing of Jesus Christ. Today, the Lord has set before you life and death. Choose life. Choose life. Repent. So we have God's plan. We have his provision. We have his purpose. And then finally, we have God's promise. We have God's promise. But you, Jeremiah, dress yourself for work. Arise and say to them everything that I command you. Do not be dismayed by them, lest I dismay you before them. This word, I think, literally, it means to shatter. Do not be shattered by them, lest I shatter you before them. And I, behold, I make you this day a fortified city, an iron pillar, and bronze walls against the whole land. Against the kings of Judah, its officials, its priests, and the people of the land. They will fight against you, but they shall not prevail against you, for I am with you, declares the Lord, to deliver you. I think it's really interesting here. So God has just laid out his plan for Jeremiah's life and then gives him a glimpse of his ministry in warning Israel of the coming judgment of the Lord because they have been wicked. And do you notice that God doesn't give really Jeremiah a choice here? Do you notice that? So, but you, dress yourself for work, arise and say to them everything that I've commanded you. He doesn't say, so Jeremiah, just told you all that. What do you think? How are you feeling about that, big guy, huh? What do you think? I would understand if you need to pray about it, right? He doesn't really give him a choice. He doesn't do that. No, he expects obedience to what he has called him to do. He expects obedience to the thing that he has called him to do. He says, dress yourself for work. Get ready. Arise and say to them everything that I have commanded you. And listen, he expects the same from us. He expects obedience to what he has called us to. That's right. Not how do I feel about it? Not what do I think about it? Not do I need to pray about it? He expects obedience to what he has called us to do. God promises Jeremiah that it's gonna be difficult. It's gonna be difficult. They will fight against you. It is going to be a difficult calling, a difficult ministry. But he will be with him. He will be with him. So get up and go to work. No matter how hard the calling might be, no matter how difficult the calling, Jeremiah needs to get up and dress himself for work and say everything God commands him to say. He is not to be shattered, dismayed. He has promised God's protection, his presence. He will be a fortified city. His ministry is going to be hard and difficult and brutal. When we read through the whole book of Jeremiah, we see so many areas where it is just a hard ministry that Jeremiah has. I'll just give you one thing. Jeremiah 18, 18. Then they said, come, let us make plots against Jeremiah. For the law shall not perish from the priest, nor counsel from the wise, nor the word from the prophet. Come, let us strike him with the tongue, and let us not pay attention to any of his words. They come against Jeremiah. They mock Jeremiah. They don't understand a word that he says, Jeremiah. They ignore him. It was a hard ministry, and there's so many more verses in Jeremiah about how he was severely treated. It's in fact so hard for Jeremiah, the ministry was so hard, that Jeremiah is known as the weeping prophet. He is known as the weeping prophet because he wept a lot. Think of even other prophets in the Old Testament and the difficulties that they went through, the hardship that they went through, how difficult their ministry was, all because of the message that they were given to proclaim. Yet, they were faithful to God and his message, no matter what, no matter the difficulty, no matter how hard, no matter how many excuses they might have had, no matter how reluctant they might have been. God expects obedience to the things that he has called us to. And the ministry of the Old Testament prophets was hard and difficult and brutal. And as our culture that we live in today becomes even more against Christ and Christians, and it is, our ministry to those around us will get even tougher, even more difficult. Some of us don't even want to get started or get to work because we think it's going to be too tough. And I don't want to sugarcoat anything for you. Ministry is tough. It's tough now. But can I just say that it's worth it? Because it is the work of the Lord. It is the work of the Lord, and therefore it is worth doing. When I think about this passage, I'm reminded of my dad. And my dad is an incredibly hard worker, incredibly hard worker. Most of my life, I just remember my dad waking up at just incredible hours in the morning, 3:30 in the morning, 4 o'clock in the morning, to get up and get ready for work. Because he would have to drive from where we lived in Wisconsin to Skokie, Illinois, which is where his job was, which is a pretty long drive. So he would wake up so early, he would get up, he would go to work, and then he, of course, would have to come home from work, which was another brutal drive, would get stuck in traffic. And he wouldn't get home until late at night, and then he would go to bed, and he would do the same thing the next day, and the next day, and the next day, and the next day, and then he would work overtime on Saturday, and then the next day, you know, it was all the time he was working, and he was working, and he was working. And the reason that he did that, I'm sure he had a lot of excuses when he woke up in the morning. When that alarm went off at 3:30, I don't know, have you ever tried to wake up at 3:30 in the morning? I have. I got a lot of excuses, you know. Man, this is awful. Where's the sun? It's there's so many excuses that I'm sure he had. I hate the drive. The drive is awful. What can I just find something closer? Can I find something that's not, that I don't have to wake up so early? Excuse. I'm sure there were so many day after day after day after day. But the thing that was more worthy to him than the hardship and the difficulty was to be able to provide for our family. To be able to provide for his kids and his wife. To make sure that they had all the things that they needed. And so he got up every day, even though it was hard, and he worked because the work was worthy. It was more worthy than the difficulty. So the question then is do you believe that the work that God has called you to is more worthy than the difficulty that is going to happen, than the hardship that will come, than the excuses that you make? Do you believe that the work of the Lord that God has called you to is more worthy than that. I believe that it is. And I believe that God is with us in the work and provides everything that we need. His provision is his presence. And so just like Jeremiah, God has a plan for your life. It's probably not to be a prophet, but he has a unique calling on your life. You are uniquely planted. What is it that God has for you? And in that unique planting, God is going to provide for you. Even when we give him excuses, he is going to supply our every need. God has a purpose for you for such a time as this, right now in our culture, where you live, where you work, to be on mission for his son, Jesus Christ. And God promises his protection and presence even when it's difficult, even when it's hard, and the work of the Lord is worthy. So church, let's dress ourselves for work. Let's arise and let's say everything that God has commanded us to say and do everything that God has commanded us to do. And let us trust and believe that God is with us. Amen? Let's pray. God, we thank you for your word. We thank you for the instruction that you have for us. Lord, we thank you, Lord, that you are with us. Lord, I pray right now that we would be obedient to the call that you have for us, that we would step into the ministry that you have for us, in the church, in the places that we live, wherever that might be, that we would step in with boldness because we know that you are with us. Lord, we know that it is going to be difficult and hard, but the work of the Lord, your work, Lord, is worthy. It is more worthy than the difficulty that we will face, the hardship that we will face, any excuse that we could give. And so, Lord, would you help us? We need your help. We need you. And you say you will be with us. And so, Lord, we thank you for that. Help us, Lord, as we go out through our week on mission for you, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen, church. Let's stand together. Let's sing one more song, Worship to the Lord, before we go today.
Calling heaven down your way. You
so faithful to us. And he is worthy of the call. What has he called you to today? Maybe there is something in your life that is hindering you from the mission that God has called you to. Maybe there's a sin pattern. Maybe there's something that's holding too much importance in your life that is keeping you from the Lord. It's time to surrender that today. So we're gonna have leaders up at the front that will be able to pray for you and be able to help you through that. Maybe you're wondering, hey, I feel called to something and I have no clue what to do with it. I feel called into ministry. I feel called to change my job. I feel called to step out into something. We wanna partner with you in prayer. We wanna encourage you. That's what the body of Christ does. We encourage each other to live on mission for the Lord. That's what we get to do together. We get to encourage one another. So today we get to live on mission and know that his presence is with us. So we'll have people down at the front to pray for you. And then I'll be in the lobby. If you're new, I'd love to meet you, help you get connected here at Harvest. But as you go out on mission today with the presence of the Lord with you, know that you are loved. Have a great day.